Welcome back, everyone. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. We are here live at our NYSE CUBE studios on the East Coast. We got Palo Alto and Silicon Valley connecting to Wall Street here at the NYSE as part of theCUBE and the NYSE Wire community, an open community of leaders breaking down all the action. We're here for Citi and Robotics Media Week as well as our AI leaders going on. We have Christian Kurasek, CFO of Pronto AI, doing autonomous trucks, but a lot more. Founding team from Waymo and originally Uber and Wells with all the autonomous action technology. Christian, thanks for coming on theCUBE, appreciate
it. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we were talking before we came on camera, the challenges in autonomous, anything fully autonomous is challenging. And you guys are doing that technology and your market starting in a very controlled area, which is a great way to make money right away.
Exactly.
It's a good way to get started and not run out of cash. But you got big ambitions. So lay out Pronto AI. What are you guys doing? What's the vision?
Sure. Our team has been focused on how do we commercialize autonomy today. Not 5 years in the future, which has been for the last 15 years. It's only 5 years away. Some say only 1 year away. And so when we looked at the market, we looked at the state of the technology. We identified the biggest addressable market where we could commercialize it today, where customers had a pressing need, was the mining and coring industries. Very controlled environments, very labor constrained, huge safety considerations. It's a $1 trillion part of the global economy. Always has been, always will be. There's a saying, if it's not grown, it's mined. And it's very true if you think about it. And so our vision, let's start with where we can create a profitable business today. Mm-hmm. We're on track, we think, to be the world's first profitable autonomous vehicle company. Yeah. And let's go from there as the technology evolves and start expanding our sphere of product suite. So right now we're doing mining trucks, the big yellow iron you see driving around mining sites, quarry sites. We'll expand to other pieces of equipment. Eventually our vision is to automate everything with wheels.
I mean, it's a smart move as CFO because why not make money on the entry strategy as you guys build out the software? And you mentioned it's a pretty big market. Talk about that, because I think, you know, I see the big trucks, they're monster trucks, huge CapEx. Mm-hmm. I mean, you mentioned there's a huge labor issue, shortage, how do you find people, safety concerns always in autonomy. Almost a risk management move and profit move. Was that intentional?
Absolutely, very intentional. We can make money doing it. There's big dollars involved, so as you noted, some of these mining trucks can cost $5, $6, $7 million. If you are running an operation where you're pulling a global commodity out of the ground like gold, you want to run 24/7 and be as productive as possible. You lose 20% of your productivity of those machines off the top just by having a human in the seat. So that's shift changes, pre-shift inspections, breaks, absenteeism. You need something like 4.5 drivers per truck to keep it going 24/7. So the costs add up very quickly. And if you actually do an analysis and look at, should I be spending $5, $6 million in a 400 ton truck or should I have 10 times as many 40 ton trucks? Without the humans in the seats, the math actually says the smaller 40 ton trucks. So it's very clear to us the future of off-road haulage is autonomous. And with those kind of economics, it's just a no-brainer. And so to your point, making money in a business is kind of a novel strategy in this space. So that's very intentionally.
The fastest way to stay in business is not to run out of cash,
exactly.
As I say.
Exactly.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, I mean, you think architecturally, whether you're talking about system architecture on a big IT project or you're laying out the monolithic truck broken down into smaller trucks makes sense because you're now essentially automating almost a factory of trucks. Mm-hmm. That's now autonomous, you can make them predictable. What kind of software is involved? What's the tech behind the scenes? What's some of the secret sauce? I mean, obviously, the model works because now it's a throughput game, mm-hmm. right? No humans there, mm-hmm. so you don't need to worry about the truck sizes. That makes sense. What have some of the successes look like? What's the secret sauce behind all this?
So we used camera only. We're not doing any other sensors, and we use IMUs and GPS, things like that, but so we very intentionally kept the tech stack light. It needs to be affordable. If you look at some of the incumbent competitors we're competing against, the big OEMs, you know, their systems cost 10 times what ours do. So there's a very small market in terms of number of machines that make sense. So we're keeping it easy to use, easy to install, fast to deploy, make the economics work at all scales, yeah. Not just the biggest trucks, the biggest mines.
Complexity is reduced, you don't have to worry about LiDAR or anything like that, right?
Correct, so it makes the sensor fusion simpler, less things breaking you have to worry about, 100%. And then being nimble and being responsive to what the customers are asking for, which kind of, you know, entry level stuff, but it's easier to do as a small.
So one of the trends we're seeing in the AI robotics week we're having here with leaders is that there's kind of two approaches. One is build something from scratch, like build a new big hauler device or retrofit an existing. Are you guys looking at that from that perspective? Obviously, you have pre-existing CapEx on equipment. Is that a hybrid for you guys? Are you doing any of your own trucks or are you guys looking at retrofitting?
We do not want to be an OEM. We don't want to build big trucks. There are something like 75,000 haul trucks out there in the world that should be retrofit to be autonomous. Those trucks can live for 10 to 20 years, depending on the operator and how well you maintain them. So it's not realistic that everybody's just going to flip their fleet tomorrow.
Yeah, so you're retrofitting. Do you retrofit or do they have to do it?
We're doing it right now. We're partnering with dealers and OEMs and training our customers on how to do it themselves. We're also talking to OEMs about integrating further up in the supply chain for new trucks. That's a little bit of a different story, but
that's a
we're doing both.
That's a timeline.
Correct.
I mean, they've got to procure, they've got a supply chain constraint, there's lag there. It's like building anything, right?
Correct, yeah.
All right, so you're in the mode of, that channel's your primary. You're not building anything yourself, you're just supplying hardware for new stuff, retrofitting existing through those channels.
Correct.
All right, what about safety? That comes up a lot. We're kind of talking about the human side of it. Strollers aren't on job site, so you don't worry about a mom with her baby walking across the street. What are some of the safety there? Obviously, bigger trucks, big stuff happens, you know, good and bad. So like, what's the safety ROI? What's the safety look like picture for you guys?
You know, at a very simple level, we're taking humans out of danger. If you look at the Mining Safety Health Administration publishes fatality injury data, basically in real time, you can log onto their website and see what's happened this year. The vast majority of injuries that happen are powered haulage. So it's somebody in a truck that flips over, it's a truck driving over another vehicle because it's too small and outside the field of view of the driver. So by using sensors to avoid things like that, by taking humans out of the cab, we are completely changing the game by eliminating those risks. Robots don't get tired. Robots don't show up to work drunk.
They don't need a pee break. You know.
Exactly. So it's significant, and that's also a huge motivator for our customers.
Yeah.
Because they take it very seriously, as they should, and it's also very expensive when anything happens. You have to shut it down, shut the plant down, do an investigation. So it makes sense kind of on every level.
And the workflows are predictable, makes sense, right? I mean, you have somewhat a controlled environment relative to what the operation is. It changes, obviously, when conditions change, but it's not like real time. Nothing real time is happening other than the truck's moving.
You're essentially driving in a big circle. That's how I like to put
it. It's like a factory of trucks, you know?
It's exactly right, yeah.
That's cool. Talk about the origination story. We were talking a little earlier before we came on again. How'd you guys get here? Talk about the origination, where you guys started from, what year, and give some numbers of what you guys are doing.
Yeah, for sure. So our founding team, as we talked about, traces the roots all the way back to the 2004 DARPA Grand Challenge. Ended up being a co-founder of Waymo, started Uber's autonomy platform, that's now Uber Freight, and then in 2018, Pronto was started to do on-road Class 8 ADAS. Turns out it's a very difficult business model to make work. The technology is there, but to get somebody to add cost to a very low-margin business is a difficult sell. So, as I was alluding to earlier, when we looked at where could we commercialize this today? What's the biggest market? Where's the tech ready? Mining and quarrying jumped out. So we've been at this, we did that pivot about 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago.
Yeah.
We have been, I like to say, trading up the paperclip, right? These are huge companies, very high throughput, high revenue producing sites, you cannot just show up and expect someone to sign off on a new technology without some proof.
Yeah.
You know, we like to say nobody ever got fired for buying IBM.
Yeah.
Very much applies here. So we've been proving ourselves at larger and larger sites. We're now dealing with, I think, 18 of the world's top quarrying companies. We have deployments or in conversations with a handful of the world's top 10 mining companies, which is huge. We've recently put out some exciting news. We just signed a global partnership agreement with Heidelberg Materials to deploy over 100 trucks worldwide over the next 3 years. They're the world's largest construction aggregates producer. We've got some other customers we're working with of similar scale. We have not disclosed yet, but we'll have some exciting
announcements. You're knocking down some wins.
We are.
And you got track record, you got some leverage there. As you look at, as the CFO, you get the financial strategy meets the business strategy. What's the operating leverage that you guys get? Is it experience with the big companies? I mean, think about how to close a deal. It's like you got to get the reps in.
Yep.
Is it that? Is it the business side that's got the advantage? Is there some other leverage you're getting with data? Take us through some of the sustainable, durable features here.
Table stakes is having a product that works and works safely.
Like you said, the go big or go home. A lot of people going home on this one.
Yeah, look, you have one big incident in this industry and you're done. It's a small industry, people talk. They're not going to put their operations at risk. So we've been very studious and careful and cautious about that. I would say the biggest operating leverage we have now is once you get one of these large operators convinced that you have a product that works, there's an ROI and it's safe, that takes time, that takes some investment. We like to say nobody wants to be first, everybody wants to be 10th.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's turning out everybody wants to be third, because now that people are seeing we're deploying at real scale, they're kind of piling in. Yeah. So that would be, I would say, the biggest operational leverage.
We always say when one penguin jumps in the water, they all jump in.
Exactly.
I mean, let's talk about some of the data you're getting on the proof points. So what are some of the metrics you're seeing that get people, wow, this is working? Because I can imagine the followers would go, wow, my competitor has an advantage, or
correct,
I'm losing, I could make more money. Whatever angle, greed, profit, operation efficiency, or just kind of the cool factor, it's not just being cool, it's relevant, and money talks, BS walks in this case, right? Because these people aren't like in for the shiny new toy.
Correct.
They're running mining operations.
Correct.
It's like.
Very brass tacks, bottom line.
Like, hey, what are you going to save me? So share me some of the data on what you guys are proving out.
Sure. So that 20% of increased productivity on the trucks you pick up just by replacing the human?
Yeah.
Huge. Like these are companies that will spend massive amounts of money to gain 1-2% improvements in productivity. So that's massive. You solve what is a huge and growing labor challenge. It's, I would say, about 1 in 4 driver seats worldwide, no matter who we're talking to, are unfilled today. Nobody wants to do these jobs. They're in remote locations. They're very rote. The workforce is aging out. So that's solving a huge pain point there. And if you start looking at some of the efficiency numbers, we have empirical data. The industry has empirical data from other deployments. You see things like 40% reduction in things like brakes and tire wear. You get something like 15% reduction overall maintenance costs on a truck. You can reduce your operator costs by 75%. And if you really start to look at the big picture and you start designing mines for smaller autonomous trucks, you're looking at life of mine NPV increases of 40 or 50%. And that number sounds insane.
Yeah, it sounds
huge. We did a big study with a consulting firm called Whittle. We were like, these numbers can't be real. But now we have two different big international mining companies who've replicated that analysis internally.
Yeah.
And they confirm they're coming at it.
So you got more customers, you got more data to work with. That's proved. Those are huge numbers. I mean, it's a no-brainer. I can see the advantages. What's next? What are you guys going to do next? Stay here? Is there adjacency strategy? Or what's the playbook for growth?
Look, the tech has a lot of applications. Our near-term focus is deploy as fast as possible to as many sites as possible now that we kind of have that market validation and you know, the product market fit and the safety record and all that stuff. So haulage is kind of the low-hanging fruit. We're going to be very laser-focused on that. There are adjacencies on other pieces of equipment at a mine, loaders, excavators, dozers. technically more difficult,
yeah,
but very, very lucrative to start yeah. automating the ecosystem, collecting all that data, being able to optimize the site through robots versus humans. But eventually our vision is to automate everything with wheels, starting with the off-road market. Ports should be automated. It's a political issue, yeah. Much more than a technical issue. They're very easy technically to do. It's so there's a lot of things like that where yeah. you know, we want to build
and you guys are buying some time, making some money.
Correct.
Moving the system out, getting data.
Correct.
Use cases.
So that I mean, that's been the Achilles heel of all these autonomous vehicle companies that have gone out of business yeah. is how do you sustain it until you get to a point where you've got product market fit?
I'm saying economic value proposition. I mean, technical hurdles, yes. But as you know, you can address that at the complexity, but you've got somewhat simple execution, relatively speaking, in autonomous. But it's an economic value proposition with those numbers.
Yeah.
And so I can imagine midterm. So what's your goals at Citi? What's your goals for the conference here and meeting folks? You see industry peers here, obviously investors. You guys looking to raise money? What's the current situation?
We're not actively raising. You know, we are scaling up and looking at alternatives for how to do that most efficiently. So, you know, we're here to just take steps for the market.
Is dev opportunities, potentially partnerships?
Absolutely, see what's going on with, yeah. with our compatriots. And
test the waters, see how competitive the advantage is.
Yeah, awesome. I mean, actually, I just wanted to come here and be able to see the trading floor. At
NYC. Get your tour.
Yeah.
Well, Christian, thanks for coming on, I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. All right, we're bringing it down here. Autonomy's here, obviously the use case is smart strategy. You know, get the low-hanging fruit. It's pragmatic, but get the beachhead and just inch by inch, and then when you move the ball down the field, take those opportunities again that they're doing it here, Pronto AI. Of course, theCUBE's moving the ball down the field with the content coverage here at the NYSE. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. Thanks for watching.